So I was meant to go to the week before. The week before lineup was stupid, like really, really stupid good. Gerd Janssen, who else was playing? Actually, let me get it up on here. Let me get it up on here. Let me get it up on here. Let me put this on the big screen so you can see it. So this is what this is obviously the night that I went to, Saturday the 6th of November. Bergkamp obviously had Natty Sears, Ben Klock, Dax J, Stephanie Sice, Nojebo and Steffi. And then Panama Bar, you had Luigi Devernier, Massimiliano Pellegrini, and Boakmaker, Andy Boakmaker, Mystery Affair, Virginia, and Jennifer Cardini. But the one that I really went to go to that I missed out on because there was a bit of a conflict at work with my kind of holiday dates and whatnot, and other people went to go at the same time, which was a killer. But again, these things happen. It is what it is. Everyone kind of wants to go away at the same sort of time. You're feeling a little bit disgruntled. You want to get a break. Da, 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 da. I can't understand it. But the one I really went to go to was this one. It was, I think, the last month of October. That lineup was crazy good. And I think that also coincided with some other parties that were going on in Berlin, of course, during Halloween weekend. Some really great ones. But this is the one I went to go to. This one here. This one was the fucking bomb. One that was definitely the one I kind of missed out on, and I'm really, really pissed. But again, a lot of these people are locals, so there's probably going to be a great chance you'll probably be able to see them again some other time. So this was Saturday the 30th of October. The lineup was Cressida playing Burger and Main Room, Matrix Man, Nenny H, Fadi Mohamed, Baker, Barker, sorry, Luke Slater, and Rodhead. And then in Panama Bar, you had FKA, the M4A, who I discovered on Hall. You had Cynthia, Palms Tracks, More Alien, Ruman Flugel, and Gerd Janssen closing. Like, absolutely solid lineup. Right? I've listened to, each of these people's sets on my phone, many, many a time. So that was obviously something I'd bummed out about. But, as a makeup, as a backup, this isn't a bad lineup to go and kind of see, right? You're not going to kind of begrudge the lineup of people you're going to go see. So, all in all, when I arrived, I missed Natty Sears and Ben Klock. I just arrived just after Ben Klock actually finished. So I got in about what? Yeah, just arrived. So I arrived at 7, going a half 8. Yeah, so I missed Ben Klock. And then I also missed Luigi Devernier and Massimiliano Pellegrini Pagliara, but I also got to saw N. Boakmaker from the start, basically into the middle, then jump back into Dax J, went back and forth for a bit, right? First of all, the good. ND Boakmaker was fantastic. Like, really, really controlled that room from the beginning to end. It was great to see somebody playing that Panorama Bar and also kind of slipping in some kind of Berghainy type sounds in there, right? There was a lot of kind of, I don't know, stuff that sounded like it was 130-ish up going in terms of BPM. Because if you want to talk about BPMs, you'd say Panorama Bar is like 90 to 129, and then Berghain is 129 BPM to anything above, to about 160, whatever it may be. But it was good to hear him play this stuff a little bit more faster that was in there. I felt like he controlled the room really well. It looked like he had a lot of friends in there that were kind of there to kind of for moral support, which always kind of helps with the atmosphere. I think a lot of friends and family there, kind of really having a good time and raving and bringing him copious amounts of cigarettes and drinks and shit. So he was actually having a blast. I got to briefly say, thanks for playing amazing music, which I think you should also say. As a note, if you do bump into artists or DJs that you like, keep it brief. Don't give me a life story. Don't show them stuff on your phone. Just keep it nice and brief. Like, hey, appreciate what you do. Keep doing your thing. You're a legend. That set was amazing. Or if you want to pick out a specific beat, a specific section, sorry. Maybe you want to ask them for a track ID. Cool. But keep it very, very brief. I try and keep it less than a minute and just kind of keep it moving. You don't want to be the kind of hanger on that's there. The last thing you want is to be the person that's trying to extract something for free. Like, oh, I want to get on your list. Oh, I want to be a friend. Oh, can you add me on Instagram? No. You don't need to do that. Just let them know, acknowledge face to face that, hey, I really appreciate that. That was really good set. Really, really put a smile on my face. Thank you so much. I'm gonna go to sleep happy now. Oh yeah, thank you, man. I'm glad you came. Boom, 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 boom. That's it. Keep moving. So that was great. He seemed like a really cool dude, which I wasn't surprised about. Again, from reading interviews of him, he seems like a pretty solid, decent lad. So that was nice to see. Then the bad has to be Dax J in the main room. I'm not too sure about what you guys think, but Dax J was very, very disappointing. I thought kind of incredibly underwhelming. More so because of what I've heard of him on sets online and what I've seen, obviously, from streams and shit. He did seem a little bit special. He did seem, he had, like, you know, sometimes some DJs come along who just seem to have the little, they seem to have the little bit of magic stardust on them. Because again, I've always said before, DJing isn't that difficult. I do it myself, to whatever level that I do it at. And I think some people kind of overcomplicate things, but there are people that come along sometimes in life who just are a bit special. People that you can't necessarily put your finger on why they're a bit special, but they just have that bit of magic stardust on them. And it's even more evident in the field like DJing, because it's so easy to do that. When someone is special, it's quite clear that they're special. And I thought Dax J was that special guy. His productions, from his DJing style, like, just, you know, there's something about his overall look, there's something about him that would may separate him. But it feels like, to me, maybe again, bad observation, but it feels like maybe the time that he's spent in this kind of business techno field, because it feels like he's kind of been flirting with that scene and playing some gigs here and there that you kind of look at, you think, huh, what's Dax J playing there, right? I think Rod had a period too where he was kind of flirting with that bit, because, you know, again, he's a person that could easily play those big awakening stages and absolutely smash them. So I get the allure, but I think overall what it might have done, it might have inflated his bank balance, I'm pretty sure, brand deals, all that good stuff. But I think artistically it is definitely dulled his senses, it feels like, because he sounded incredibly, I won't say uninspired, but it just sounded flat. It sounded kind of like he was going through the motions. It kind of sounded like he had played a variation of that set, you know, 32 times somewhere else, you know, around the European circuit, which is understandable, right? When you get into that field of that business techno scene, you know, you get many, many gigs. That's probably why people do it, because the money is really good. You're playing all the time, nondescript, Italian, French, you know, mainland, what you call it, middle of Europe kind of sets in places, right? Eastern Europe, you're playing all these weird, weird places, but you're always getting booked, you're always getting a good fee, you get looked after most of the time, and you have a ravaged, you know, basically crowd that are just hungry to just record clips of you playing and upload it on the Instagram. So it's quite gratifying in that respect, but artistically it does do something to you, I think, because you're just in the grind, you're in the rat race. So you're very unlikely, I guess, to be spending your time in your hotel room digging for new tunes. Whatever worked for you in Bergamo, you're probably going to start doing in Napoli. Whatever worked for you in Bordeaux, you're probably going to do when you get to Krakow. Do you know what I mean? Why not? Because you're literally not even there for more than 12 hours, so it makes more sense to just keep continuing copy and pasting. And I found for myself, the only time that I did start to get better at DJing was obviously when I started to play more regularly, and also when I started to challenge myself to play a completely different set every time that I played out. Of course, I'd have some elements that I wanted to keep track of, like, you know, some maybe combos of peak tracks that worked well. But in terms of beginning and end, I wanted it always to be different, always kind of to freshen up a little bit. And that's challenging. It's hard. It takes a lot out of you, because you have to listen to music. You have to kind of get it all tagged up in your library. You have to organize it into subfolders and shit. It takes a lot of work to do that. But the easiest way to do it is just to kind of get a banging set and just kind of rinse and repeat and maybe change some tunes here and there. So I did feel like Dax J was incredibly flat, incredibly uninspired, somewhat boring, and it was kind of more evident when the likes of Stephanie Sykes and Nur Jabba came on after the fact, right? They completely outshone him, like completely. Like the difference in quality, the difference in tempo, the difference in just the vibe overall was amazing. And even the thing that Dax J did as well, that was funny. He was doing those kind of big room Carl Cox style breakdowns on his tunes as well. There's a lot of that. I was thinking, what is this? Is this flipping Charlotte DeWitt? Like, I was confused. I didn't really get what was going on there. But again, Stephanie Sykes, Nur Jabba, incredible back-to-back. I think that might have been one of the standout sort of like back-to-back sets, in terms of one after the other. They were obviously sick there, really enjoyed that. Virginia in flipping Panorama Bar was fucking incredible. It doesn't need to be said, but it does need to be said in one way. She does look incredibly different in real life, like way more attractive in real life than in pictures, which is mad. Doesn't need to be said, but she played loads of classic hits. I was singing my heart out to fucking Midnight Magic, Beam Me Up remix. I don't know which one she played, but I was flipping screaming my heart out off that when that was coming on. So that was absolutely great to see. And I think I missed Jennifer Cardini, because I left about, I'm going to say 7 p.m. or something around that kind of lark. I ended up leaving because, you know, I was just kind of knackered from all the other events that I'd gone to throughout that weekend. But overall, a fairly decent night, I thought, in general. Again, it's always good to be reminded of the levels when it comes to DJs, when it comes to club nights in general. It's always good to be reminded, right, of the levels, and I think that's a good thing about going to Burkhan in that respect. I would say maybe post-pandemic, it probably doesn't have the same punch as it did before, because I think from nowadays, I'm not sure about you guys, but I've kind of learned how to love my own city a lot more. I've kind of learned how to love my own home, my own friends, right? That are in my vicinity, and to do more with what I already have than try and seek other things, because again, we've been limited with our other things that we can do. And now I'm not really longing to go to these places as much as I was in the past. Before, these were like the major parts of my year. They were kind of the ones that set the tone, the ones that maybe made up for a shitty year here back home. But we've had so many great parties here in London, so many great parties here in the UK overall that I've kind of been to, club nights and shit, and places reopening up, that there doesn't really need to, there's not a real big desire to keep going to these places all the time. I'm still gonna go because again, I still think it's good to be reminded of the levels. There's kind of levels to all these sort of things, and Burkhan still kind of again occupies the top of that kind of food chain in terms of consistently being able to book great people and putting on great nights overall. And again, just in terms of the overall experience, once you're in, it's fucking fantastic. It's always good to go. It's always good to be in a club where everyone is majority for the majority of the people that are in there, they're all dancing. That's always a great reminder of like, oh, this is what clubbing is meant to be like, right? Everyone's going crazy, tops off, you know, shaking their ears and just fucking going for it. No one cares about what you're wearing, what you look like. They're just flipping, dancing in the dark and getting sweaty and enjoying every piece of it. So that is fantastic. And there's a real lack of people staring at the DJ and shit. It's just a real cool thing vibe anyway. All that is really, really good. But there's not the calling, the desire to go there as much as there was previously. It's just not the same thing, because again, the world has changed, things are different, people are enjoying where they are a lot more, and I'm doing the same with myself going forward. And again, like I said before, the whole queuing thing and not getting selected can, you know, it can leave a sour taste in the mouth when you're the one that gets in, because it feels as if like, you know, really, it's just a club, right? Do you know what I mean? But we get it in the end of it, we get it. So again, great night, really enjoyed it. Don't have any complaints really in that regard. What else was it occurred? Saw some people that I've recognized from here and they're out and about, out and about. You know, there's no real need to kind of, you know, do all that kind of introductions in those kind of places. You don't know where people's heads are at and whatnot. So that is one thing, he left it to the side. But all in all, really great night. Really enjoyed it. I'll say probably standout set that I would kind of go to, maybe Virginia, in terms of getting me up and down, because I was absolutely losing my mind for that set. I really, really fucking enjoyed it. And then of course, second would be my guy ND. Bowmaker, however you pronounce that. I think he did really well too, amazingly. So yeah, really, really enjoyed it. Really great night. I really recommend, if you haven't been before, that you do check it out, because again, it's still one of the best clubbing experiences that you could ever go to, especially if you're not, you know, aware of all these things that we do, or if you're not aware of the scene in general, you want to be reminded of why these places are highly rated. Definitely, that's a good place to go. I definitely recommend it.